Hi student, in this video we are going to see the reheat cycle. So the actually reheat cycle is used into the Rankine cycle to improve the overall efficiency of the cycle. Okay, so in the reheat cycle, what is happening or what are the changes in the original or the simple Rankine cycle that we are going to see? Then we are going to see the efficiency whenever we using the reheat cycle and the advantages and disadvantages of the reheat cycle. Okay, in the reheat cycle, so generally in the Rankine cycle there are four main parts. The first one is the boiler. Okay, the second one is the turbine, third one is the condenser, and fourth one is the pump. This pump, okay, those are the four main components of the simple Rankine cycle. In reheat cycle, what we do, we are adding some extra component to increase or to improve the efficiency of this power plant or the Rankine cycle. So how it is work, that we are going to see first. So from the boiler, the whatever the liquid water is converted into the steam. Okay, mostly in the most of the thermal power plant, the steam is in the superheated state. Okay, superheated state. Then this steam is giving to the turbine. So in turbine, what will happen? The expansion of the steam will happen. Okay, means the pressure will reduces. Okay, pressure reduces, also the temperature also reduces, and that means the reduction in the pressure will cause the generation of the work, and that work is given to the generator for the further procedures. Now in the reheat cycle, what will happen? We expand the steam from the pressure P1 to the P3, or we can say the P1 to the P2. Okay, after partially expansion of the steam, okay, again we take that steam out from the turbine. Okay, we again mix it or the pass through this heater, or we can say the heat exchanger. In this heat exchanger, what will happen? We increases the temperature of this steam. Okay, and again we convert that into the superheated steam, because when the steam is expanded into this first stage, the superheated steam, the temperature will be reduces, temperature also reduces. So this superheated steam is converted into the dry saturated steam. First it will convert into the dry saturated steam, and after that it will goes to the wet steam. Okay, so when this steam will attain the dry saturated state, that steam will be, we again extract the steam from the turbine. Okay, pass through this heater or the heat exchanger, and in this heat exchanger or the heater, we again convert that state of the steam into the superheated steam. Okay, it may be from dry saturated to the superheated steam, or from wet state to the superheated steam. Okay, and again this superheated steam is passed through the second stage of the turbine. Okay, so say in the second stage, what will happen? The pressure will be P3 or P2, and the second stage, it is pressure again, that superheated steam is expanded, and that pressure reduces from P2 to P3. And after the reduction, after the second stage expansion, that steam, wet steam, is goes to the or given to the condenser. Here also expansion will happen, that and that superheated steam converted into the wet steam. And that wet steam again pass through the condenser. Here normally we rejected the heat, again converted into the condensate. That condensate is passed through this pump. Pump will increases the pressure and given to the boiler. Okay, so we just adding this part. We just adding this particular part. Sorry. We just adding this particular part into the reheat cycle. Okay, so that's how the reheat cycle will work. Now we are going to see that cycle, reheat cycle onto the TS and HS graph. Okay, so generally when we saw the ranking cycle, we got from the 6 to the 1. Okay, from 1 it will expansion will happen, and with the adiabatic expansion will happen, means entropy remain constant. Ideally entropy remain constant and this adiabatic expansion will takes place. Okay, from 7 it will enters into the condenser, some heat is rejected, okay, and that wet steam is converted into the dry saturated liquid or liquid, okay, saturated liquid, and that liquid, in this liquid we increases the pressure of this liquid by using the pump. Okay, here the pump work is very negligible, that's why we neglecting that pump work, and after that we giving to it to the boiler. In the boiler we adding the heat to the water and again we convert it into the steam. Okay, so that's how the normal Rankine cycle will work. Okay, in the reheat cycle there is a change whenever the expansion will takes place. Expansion will takes place into the two stage. Okay, first stage, in the first stage expansion will take from the pressure P1 to the pressure P2. That is the first stage. Okay, whenever during the expansion, when the steam is start converted into the wet steam, okay, and whenever it is enters into the wet region, that steam again we extracted from the turbine. Okay, we extract that steam and again we reheat that steam. So this is the from point 2 to 3, that is the process where reheating will be done. We adding more heat and again we converting that steam into the superheated steam. Okay, so we got the point 3. Okay, so at point 3 pressure is constant, pressure is not changing because we adding the heat at the constant pressure. After the when we convert that heat or the steam into the superheated steam, again we pass through this into the second stage. So this stage from 3 to 4, it is the second stage expansion. Again it is the same expansion, it is the adiabatic or the constant entropy expansion, or we can say the isentropic expansion. Okay, so after the second stage, when we expand into the second stage, it is converted to the wet steam. Okay, and that wet steam will be provided to the condenser. Okay, so that's how the reheat cycle, we can plot it on the TS diagram. Okay, so whatever the area you are saying under this crossed area, this area is presented the increment in the work done due to the reheating. So as we know the thermal efficiency, we know our work output upon the whatever the heat input. So as work output increases, definitely the efficiency will be increases. There will be no doubt that we the work input also increases and this heat input also increases, because we have to add heat in this particular reheating process also. Okay, but the quantity of heat addition increment is less than the quantity of work increment. That's why the overall, when we saw the thermal efficiency of the power plant will increases. Okay, the another most important aspect, that only maximum in practice maximum two reheats only acceptable, because whenever we go for the third and fourth reheating process, the whatever the heat added, this Q in amount will again increases tremendously, and that's why the overall efficiency will decreases when we go for the third and fourth reheating process. That's why in practice only this reheating is limited up to the two times or two reheating processes. Okay, similarly this cycle we can plot it on the HS diagram. Okay, those are the constant pressure processes, that is P1, P2 and P3 lines. This is the first expansion where we got the first turbine work. Okay, after that this is the heat addition process or the reheating. Okay, and the second turbine were we got from the process 3 to 4. Okay, so these crossed sir area, that's how much work will be increased by using the reheating process. Okay, so in actual practice, reheating improves the cycle efficiency by about 5% for 85/15 bar cycle. Means this P1 is the 85 and the P3 value is 15 bar. So for this system, the total improvement in the cycle efficiency is about 5%. Okay, the second reheat will give a much less gain, while the initial cost involved would be so high as to prohibit use of two-stage reheat except in the case of very high initial throttle conditions. So generally, we limited this reheating cycle into the one stage only. Only one reheat is allowable, because when we go for the second reheat, the cost of the construction will increases. Okay, and that increased cost of the construction will nullify the effect of improvement in the thermal efficiency. That's why generally in practice we only go for the one or single reheat process. We are not going for the second one unless the initial throttle conditions pressure or the very high initial throttle conditions are there. Okay, the improvement in the thermal efficiency due to reheat is greatly dependent upon reheat pressure with respect to the original pressure of the steam. Okay, now how we calculate the thermal efficiency? Similar to the previous one, we have to find out the reheat or whatever the heat supplied. Okay, we supplied the heat into the first stage and this is during the second stage. Okay, now what is the heat rejected? We rejected heat during the condensation only, that is H4 minus HF4, that is straight line. Now the work done by the turbine, that is we get it from the first law of thermodynamics, that is the heat supplied minus heat rejected. Okay, because for the cyclic process, the thermodynamic law is delta Q is equal to delta W. Okay, so from this first law of thermodynamics, we applied that first law into this particular application and we got this work done by the turbine by just minimizing the rejected heat from the supplied heat. Okay, so the thermal efficiency formula is net work done upon whatever the heat input. Okay, we're just putting all those values and we got this efficiency formula for the reheat system. Okay, if pump work we are considering, we have to minus the pump work from both of these quantities. Okay, but generally the pump work we neglect because this quantity is very small when we compare it to the turbine work. Okay, so the thermal efficiency we can see as known as the or given by the H1 minus H7 upon H1 minus HF4, because HF4 and HF7 is the same one. Okay, so just consider this thermal efficiency formula and there are some questions may be asked into the end semester examination based upon explanation of the reheat system or the explanation of the regenerative cycle. Okay, now the advantages, as we know, it will increases the efficiency, right? Efficiency, overall efficiency of the power plant. It is increases the output of the turbine. This delta T, work of the turbine will increases in this particular cycle. Erosion and corrosion problems in the steam turbine are eliminated. Because why these problems are eliminated? Because when this steam during the first expansion will enter into the wet region, we again reheat that one. So after the second region, the value of X is more than 85%. Okay, that's why the less moisture will be there at the exit of the turbine, and because of that the erosion and corrosion problem will reduces. Third one, there is an improvement in the thermal efficiency, as we already know. Fourth one, final dryness fraction of the steam will improve because the X value will improve. The fifth one, there is an increase in the nozzle and blade efficiency because of the decrement in the erosion and the corrosion problems. Those are the advantages of the reheat cycle. Similarly, there are some disadvantages. Reheating required more maintenance because the heater, we have to add heater, that will cost more maintenance or the more cost, initial cost. And the increasing the thermal efficiency is not appreciable in comparison to the expenditure incurred in the reheating. Means the initial cost is very high. Initial cost of the reheating is very high, and that will cause or that will nullify the effect of improvement in the thermal efficiency. Okay, the overall profit will reduces. That's why we only limited this reheating process onto the only one reheating cycle. Okay, we are not go for the second one until it is required. Okay, so this is the all about reheat cycle.